Hello everyone. Today we will discuss the technical details of my latest project. I will show you the problems I've encountered while creating a simulation of artificial life's evolution and my solutions. These solutions may not be perfect, so feel free to share your ideas in the comments section. At the end of the video, we will talk about the insides of the genome in my simulation. We will also touch on the issue of the movement of energy inside a multicellular organism and how to channel energy to specific cells. Let's begin with the cell's execution order. The simulation is run on a CPU, so you must go through all the cells sequentially and perform the necessary actions. It is necessary to devise such a solution that none of the cells would have an advantage from the execution order. The simplest solution is to use a list and iterate over it at each simulation step. In the beginning, the first cell in the list has the advantage. But as the simulation progresses, the list turns into a continuous movement in a circle and none of the cells has any advantage from its position in the list. When the cell dies, we remove it from the list. This has no side effects nor gives any advantage. Adding cells to the list, on the other hand, can be a source of trouble. The simplest approach is to place a new cell at the end of the list. Let's say, the first cell creates a new cell. To give action to this cell, we first have to iterate through all the other cells in the list. Only after this, the cell will be able to perform certain actions to protect itself. But if a new cell is created by the last cell in the list, it can take action immediately. That is, it has an advantage over a cell that was created by a cell from the beginning of the list. Such an outcome is undesirable. Now let's see my solution. I've used a similar approach in my other projects. When the simulation begins, we immediately create a list with a size equal to the maximum possible amount of cells in the simulation. Each cell points to the previous and next cells and has a field indicating whether it is alive. A reference is just an index of the next and previous cell in the list of cells. During the simulation, we iterate in circles using a reference to the next cell. When a cell dies, we update the reference field of its next and previous cells. Here you can see how we skip the dead cell. When a new cell is created, we place it before its parent. It will take action only after other living cells. First, we find an unused cell in the list and update all the references. I think this is the most optimal way to do this. This way, none of the newborn cells will have an advantage over other newborns. Now we should discuss a cell at index 0, a zero cell. This cell is virtual, which means it has no body on the screen and is unable to affect other cells. Reaching this cell means a step of the simulation is over. We can draw a new frame and gather statistics. If you think the cell at index 4 has an advantage over the cell at index 3, you can move the zero cell, so cell 3 takes action first. But this change won't affect the order of execution, so that the zero cell doesn't bother you in any way, I'll hide it. Notice how the list transitions from one cell to another. Now let's discuss the mechanism of energy transfer inside a multicellular organism. Since in this project cells are combined into multicellular organisms, it is necessary to have a way of transporting energy inside the body in the right direction, that is, to active cells. I use the absolute coordinate system. Each cell has an array of four elements, which determine the direction of energy transfer. If the cell must transfer energy in a certain direction, then we replace an appropriate element of the array with a digit 1. If a cell has a parent, we store the direction to it. If a cell has no parent, we store a negative digit 1. Let's say our cell generates two new cells. In this case, the cell itself turns into a transport cell. The top cell has a parent below it, that is, in direction number 3. Since this is a sprout, we must transfer energy in this direction. The bottom cell is green. It has a parent above it, so we must transfer energy in this direction. Let's say, the top sprout has three branches. All three new branches are sprouts, so we must transfer energy in this direction. And so on. This way we create a single organism, each cell which stores information about its parents and direction of energy transfer. Now let's see what happens when a transport cell dies. Like this one. We iterate over its branches and tell them that their parent no longer exists. Then we tell all adjacent cells that there is no need to transfer energy anymore. After everything mentioned above is done, the cell finally disappears. Now let's see how energy flows are redirected in organisms when cells die. The upper left sprout has died. It informed the transport cell that there is no need to transfer energy in this direction anymore. If a transport cell has no direction for transporting energy, it begins to transfer energy in the direction of its parent. The parent in turn stops to transfer energy in the direction of the cell. The next cell in the row does the same. The organism structure was successfully changed and now all energy flows to the two remaining sprouts. Let's see what happens if the central sprout dies. The transport cell changes one of its directions for energy transfer, while other directions remain the same. No further changes are needed. Let's say the left green cell is dead. This will not trigger any changes in the energy transfer. Each cell takes some energy to sustain its life at every turn, but energy does not flow through some cells now. Without energy, cells begin to die. The organism structure changes again and now energy from two green cells flows to one sprout. But now the last sprout has died too. The remaining transport cells begin to redirect energy to their parents. Now all energy flows to the origin cell of the organism. It has no parent and no place to transfer energy. Energy can be accumulated only by sprouts and seeds. Which means this organism no longer has any sprouts or seeds. Its existence is meaningless, so the cell dies. So the whole body, devoid of active cells, will die along. With this solution, each cell knows exactly where to direct energy so that it reaches the sprout or seed, and having lost them, the organism dies, making room for others. But we have a problem with the speed of energy transfer. Let's see these few transport cells. Their energy must be transferred from the left corner to the right one. Let's try it. Energy has moved from left to right in one step of the simulation. Now let's reverse the direction of energy flow. In this case, in one step of the simulation, the energy was moved by only one cell. The solution for this problem is to create additional buffers and create two separate phases A and B, which alternate on each step of the simulation. Let's start the simulation. The current phase is A. During this phase, energy can be taken from buffer A and transferred to buffer B of the adjacent cell. The second cell's buffer A is empty, so it will have to wait until the next step of the simulation. In the next step, the energy will be transferred only to the third cell. Transporting energy in the opposite direction has the same principle. For each simulation step, the energy can move by only one cell. That's all the important technical points. How the formation of an organism from individual cells is implemented in this simulation and how energy is transported inside organisms. Now we will talk about the insides of the genome in the simulation. The genome is just a table of numbers from 0 to 255. There are 32 rows in total. Each sprout stores a number of active gene. This number points to the row of the genome table used for this cell. Each row is a separate gene, which consists of 21 numbers. For now, let's focus on the first 15 numbers. I divided them into groups and marked them with colors. Let's analyze each group separately. The first three numbers determine the branches of a cell and their relative direction: left, forward, and right. For example, the first number is 18. This means the cell will have a sprout in the left direction with active gene number 18. We take the remainder from dividing the number by 32. The second number is 79. So, in the forward direction, we need to create a blue cell. The third number is 201, so we will not create any branches in the right direction. After that, the cell checks whether it has enough energy to create all these branches, and if there is enough energy, then new cells are created. Otherwise, we wait for the next move and save energy. The new sprouts have an active gene 18, so it will use 18th row of the genome table. Actually, this is already enough to create a simulation. This mechanism was used in the first versions of the digital tree evolution. The gene may also contain up to two conditions to be checked. If the third or fifth numbers fall within a certain range, we need to check the condition under those numbers. Here are some examples of such conditions. Some conditions require a parameter that is specified by the fourth and sixth numbers. The numbers I've painted red encode commands. If the ninth or twelfth number has a value in the range from 0 to 14, we need to evoke one of 15 commands. And now to the last types of numbers that I've painted pink. They encode the alternate number of the active gene if it needs to be changed. The remainder of dividing by 32 is taken. Now we will see how a cell processes the gene. First, we check if there are conditions to be met. If the third or fifth numbers is higher than 67, then no conditions are set. The next step is to create branches according to the value of the first numbers. But if conditions are set and all of them are met, then the cell tries to evoke the command encoded in the ninth number. If no command is encoded, the active gene is replaced by a gene encoded in seventh number. If one of the conditions isn't met, the cell tries to evoke the command encoded in the twelfth number. If no command is encoded, the active gene is replaced by a gene encoded in eighth number. Without commands, the simulation becomes plain and simple. We can even leave one condition. This is pretty similar to the simulation I've used in the last versions of the Digital Trees Evolution project. In this project, conditions were also checked, and depending on the result of the check, the behavior could change. However, I wanted to implement complex conditions and command execution, so genome size has increased. If the command is executed, then according to the results of the execution, the cell changes its active gene to one of two variants encoded in the corresponding numbers. This way, the cell can change the active gene several times before branching, check different conditions, and execute different commands. This can create complex behavior. And finally, the last six numbers are used if it is a single cell and not a cell in the body. A singular cell requires a different set of commands. For example, moving, turning, extracting energy from the soil, eating other cells, or parasitism. Parasitism is quite an interesting command. A singular cell, being next to a transport cell, can add a direction to it to transfer energy in its direction and consider this cell to be its ancestor. Here is a simulation where such a mutation has occurred. The basis of the ecosystem is superorganisms. The excess energy from the soil is collected by singular cells, but there are some small fragments with green cells between the superorganisms. These are the remains of dead superorganisms that have long lost active cells but cannot completely disappear since parasites connect to them and suck energy. And as long as there is a place to transfer energy, the cells will exist. You can call these zombie cells. However, the ecosystem of the two species turned out to be very stable. That's all for the technical details of my project. I don't have any simple solutions or templates for creating architecture and rules for a new world yet. It all depends on the desired result. That's all for today's video. Don't forget to like and subscribe. I will be happy if you leave a comment. Special thanks to all my patrons on Patreon. Until next time.